Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our service of worship here at Dale St. Andrews Parish Church. If you're a visitor with us today, or if you're a regular, or if you're joining us online now or on catch up, we hope and pray that you feel as welcome here as you are, because you are welcomed in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Saviour. Please do take the time, if you're able, to stay behind after the service. We'll have some tea and coffee served in the large hall, and it would be great if we could spend time fellowshipping together and enjoying one another's company. And while you're through in the big hall having your tea and coffee, you might want to take a look at some photographs that have been put on the wall, photos from the holiday club we ran a couple of weeks ago. So if you are staying behind, look out for those, and it'll give you a sense or a flavour of what we were able to do here when we joined in our holiday club. Derek is not with us this week. He is away up at Cairnvale. He's chaplain to part two of the KG6 training course for young men in the Boys Brigade as they pursue their training to become officers. So please do pray for Derek and keep him and the boys in mind. It's a great opportunity for Derek to be able to share with these young men, so remember them all in prayer. But this week, if there are any pastoral concerns or anything that you might contact Derek about, then please either contact myself or Crawford Moffat, as we'll be looking after you in Derek's absence. So anything at all, please do contact either myself or Crawford. A couple of other notices to draw to your attention this morning. The news has been on the screens as you've been coming in. But one that wasn't on the screens, kind of in response to our holiday club, which saw a number of young people coming to our church building for the club, a number of children who are not already connected with our church family. In response to that, we are looking for donations for school equipment, which we are going to give to the local primary schools to give to children who might not otherwise be able to afford school equipment. Things like pencils, rubbers, that sort of thing, pencil cases. If you would like to donate something, there will be boxes at the front and back doors of the church next Sunday and the following Sunday, so the two following Sundays. And if you'd like to donate, they would be most welcome, and we can let you know in due course which schools these are donated to and who benefits from that. So please do bear that in mind. A couple of weeks ago, I was helping at Motherwell South's holiday club, and one of the ladies there asked if I would be so kind as to draw to our attention, reach out, a regular item on our news screens and something which we regularly donate to. Reach Out are very, very grateful for the amount that we give as a congregation, and they want to acknowledge that and say thank you for that. But I was asked if we would consider the possibility of not just donating foodstuffs, but also perhaps people, because I'm led to understand that they are looking for some more folks to come and help them out with the service that they provide. Now, I haven't asked her this, so do bear with me, but Jean, are you still involved in Reach Out? And would it be okay for folks to speak to you about it? That's fine. Jean says that's okay. You can come and speak to her about it. If you do have any questions, or if you would like to know more or would like to help, then Jean, I'm sure, would be happy to answer your questions and to tell you a bit more about that. So please also bear that in mind. As we come to worship God this morning, some words from the beginning of the book of Revelation, which Derek shared with us just a couple of weeks ago. Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy. And blessed are those who hear it and take to heart what is written in it, because the time is near. We believe that in coming to God in worship this morning to hear his word and to praise his name, we shall be blessed. We shall be blessed by his presence here among us. We shall be blessed by hearing his voice speaking into each of our lives. So let us look to God and worship him this day. We do so by standing and singing our opening hymn this morning, hymn number 500, Lord of Creation, to you be all praise. Let us bring ourselves and our time of worship to God in prayer. Let us pray together. Eternal and ever-loving God, you declare through the words of prophets and saints, through scripture and tradition, that you love us and you desire for us to know you more. From the creation of the world, you have chased humanity, constantly pouring your love, life, and gifts into all who bear your image. Help us to know that we are valued, that we are gifted, and that you have called us all to follow you and to build your kingdom in our world. We come acknowledging that you are beyond our highest thoughts. You are greater than we could ever imagine. Yet you come to us and offer a new way of life, a life of forgiveness, of peace, and of hope. We praise you for all you have done for us, and we wait in hopeful anticipation of all you will continue to do. You are unlike anything else we may encounter in our lives, and it is only right that we come with praise and worship. We praise you especially for the person of Jesus Christ, for the teachings he gave, for the model he gave for us to live out. We are all too aware, though, that we fail to follow the footsteps of Jesus. We struggle to love our neighbors, and at times, we do not love you. Lord, forgive us, we pray. We thank you especially that Jesus is more than just an example to us. He is our Savior. He is the one through whom you have forgiven us. And so we ask that you would forgive us when our faith is lukewarm. Forgive us when we do not act or speak as you would have us. Send your Holy Spirit among us, we pray, that we would be transformed into your likeness, and that you may give us the tools to build your kingdom here on earth. Be with us and equip us during this time, we pray. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. We are going to turn to our Bibles now, and we're picking up from where Derek left off last week at Revelation chapter 2. And this morning, we're going to be reading the next two letters to churches in that chapter, verses 12 through to 17, the letter to the church at Pergamum, and then verses 18 through to the end of the chapter to the church at Thyatira. So let us hear the word of God together. To the angel of the church in Pergamum write, "These are the words of him who has the sharp, double-edged sword. I know where you live, where Satan has his throne, yet you remain true to my name. You did not renounce your faith in me, not even in the days of Antipas, my faithful witness, who was put to death in your city where Satan lives. Nevertheless, I have a few things against you. There are some among you who hold to the teaching of Balaam, who taught Balak to entice the Israelites to sin so that they ate food sacrificed to idols and committed sexual immorality. Likewise, you also have those who hold to the teaching of the Nicolaitans. Repent, therefore, otherwise I will soon come to you and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who is victorious, I will give some of the hidden manna. I will also give that person a white stone with a new name written on it, known only to the one who receives it. To the angel of the church in Thyatira, write, these are the words of the Son of God, whose eyes are like blazing fire, and whose feet are like burnished bronze. I know your deeds, your love and faith, your service and perseverance, and that you are now doing more than you did at first. Nevertheless, I have this against you. You tolerate that woman Jezebel, who calls herself a prophet. By her teaching, she misleads my servants into sexual immorality and the eating of food sacrificed to idols. I have given her time to repent of her immorality, but she is unwilling. So I will cast her on a bed of suffering, and I will make those who commit adultery with her suffer intensely unless they repent of her ways. I will strike her children dead. Then all the churches will know that I am he who searches hearts and minds, and I will repay each of you according to your deeds. Now, I say to the rest of you in Thyatira, to you who do not hold to her teaching and have not learned Satan's so-called deep secrets, I will not impose any other burden on you except to hold on to what you have until I come. To the one who is victorious and does my will to the end, I will give authority over the nations, that one will rule them with an iron scepter and will dash them to pieces like pottery, just as I have received authority from my Father. I will also give that one the morning star. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Amen. And thanks be to God for this, the reading of his holy word today. We're going to continue in our service of worship by singing hymn number 605, Thanks to God Whose Word Was Spoken. I picked this hymn because I particularly liked the words, but the tune was one which wouldn't have been familiar, so Eric has chosen another tune, Rudlan, and we will sing to that tune. If you are following on the hymn sheets, just to let you know, there is actually a word missing in the fourth line of the first verse. If you're watching on the screens, though, that has been corrected. I think it should be fired her vision, tried her worth. So just bear that in mind as you're singing. So let us stand and sing together hymn number 605, Thanks to God Whose Word Was Spoken.
Thank you.
Let's share in a prayer as we consider this passage. Lord God, we thank you that your word is one which speaks to us this day. We thank you for all passages of Scripture, those which we may receive readily and those which challenge us. We pray as we look to your word this day and go deeper to understand what it might mean for us, that we would hear your voice speaking into our lives. Use this time, Lord, to speak to us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. I don't know how many sermons I've preached so far in my career. Vocation, it's not a career, it's a vocation to be a minister. I don't know how many I've preached, but I know for certain that by the time I finish here, it will be over 70 sermons. And of those, I have only ever preached on passages from Revelation, I think, on four occasions, this one being the fourth. And I remember one of the times that I was preaching on the end of Revelation, famous verses at chapter 21. It was in summer of 2013, and after the service, I was shaking hands at the door of this particular church, and an older gentleman shook my hand and said, "Let me give you some advice, son." You're laughing, you know this is... You get a sense of what's coming. He said, "John Calvin wrote a commentary on every book of the Bible except for Revelation because he thought it was too difficult. If Calvin thought it was too difficult, maybe you should too." You're laughing, but I wasn't when he said that. Because basically what he was saying to me was, if Calvin didn't do anything in Revelation, then neither should you, young man. Son, that's what he called me. And I remember that there were a number of other people that gave some very positive feedback on that sermon. But I couldn't tell you a word that they said, because negative feedback just has that strange knack of staying with you, even if a load of other people have said something very positive. Now, I would disagree with his view, because as the verses that we shared in just at the beginning of this service say, blessed is the one who considers the prophecy from the book of Revelation. But when I was preparing today's sermon, I could kind of see what he was getting at when he said, it's difficult. Because preparing the message today on the two churches that we read of was a challenge. Sometimes when you're preparing a sermon, things flow easily, and it's a true joy to then stand up on a Sunday and share what God has been speaking through the week in a preparation. Other times it feels more like hard labor, hard graft, having to spend hours and hours reading, reflecting, thinking, what on earth is this passage saying to us? And that was my experience of this past week. And I share that with you not because I'm looking for sympathy or because I'm giving you a pre-warning that this may not be up to the usual standard, but simply to let you know that, you know, even someone who has spent years studying theology comes to passages in the Bible and finds it difficult. It's something we all experience. Just because I'm training to be a minister doesn't make it any easier for me. Part of the challenge in preparing this sermon is because, as Derek has shared already, that the natural thing to do with these passages is to look at what Jesus said to the churches then, and then take that and say, what is Jesus saying to the church now? But that's not our purpose this morning. Our purpose is, as part of the wider Essential Jesus series, to ask ourselves, what do these letters say, not necessarily to the church, but what do these letters tell us about Jesus and who he is? And so of both letters to the churches, we're going to be asking that question, who is Jesus to each of these churches? And then part of understanding who Jesus is, we do need to ask, why does he encourage each church and why does he challenge each of them? And then we can arrive at the much fuller question of, what does all this say? What does this tell us about who Jesus is, and then what does it say to us today? And so we start that investigation, if you will, with the church at Pergamum. Jesus reveals himself to this church as the one who wields a double-edged sword. He is the one who knows where the church lives, and Jesus goes on to explain what that means. He says, I know you live in the place where Satan has made his throne. And to understand that, we first need to understand where the church at Pergamum was. Pergamum was the main Roman city in that region. It was the place where the Roman governor resided, and so it was the seat of power for the Roman Empire in that region. And so when Jesus is addressing this church, he's addressing it and saying, you're in the place where the Roman Empire has its power. You're in a place which, because of the multicultural nature of the Roman Empire, there's lots of different things going on. There's this temple to that god and that temple to this god, and there's all sorts of challenging things. You'll be under pressure in this place to kind of keep your Christianity quiet, because the Christian faith challenges both the temples but also the civil authorities. In Rome, Caesar was known as the Son of God. Well, the Christians could never say that because Jesus is the Son of God. And so that's the context in which Jesus is speaking to this particular church. Jesus uses the image of one that wields a double-edged sword, and that's significant, especially given the place, the seat of power of the Roman Empire. Because the Roman governor would have been represented by a sword, a symbol of his authority and his power, a sword. But it would have been a single-edged sword. So in other words, a sword in which the front side of the blade was sharp and could kill, but the other side was blunt and could do nothing. Jesus says, I don't wield a single-edged sword. I wield a double-edged sword. And so what Jesus is trying to convey is that whatever power the Roman governor says he has, I've got more. I am more powerful than Rome in this place. So he's trying to encourage them, He also encourages them by drawing to the church's attention a few of the things that they are doing well, things that he commends them for. He says, you have remained true to my name. And so in this context of pressure to abandon the name of Jesus, Jesus is saying, I commend you because you've remained true to me. Even under pressure, you still say, I'm a follower of Jesus Christ. And under this pressure, he also encourages them that they've not renounced their faith. Because I'm sure that we all know people that will say, yeah, I'm a Christian, I follow Jesus. But you dig a wee bit deeper into their lives, and that is baseless. Their lives do not reflect the faith that they say they have. And so Jesus commends them. Not only have they stayed true to his name by saying, yes, we're Christians, but they've also held to that, going much deeper into their lives, to the faith that grounds who they are. But it's not all rosy for the church at Pergamum. There are things which Jesus must challenge them about. The first is, he says that there are those that are holding to the teaching of Balaam, which is a wee bit of an obscure reference to an Old Testament prophet. Balaam was the prophet. You might know the story. He was a prophet in the Old Testament. He's the one that had the talking donkey. He was hired by King Balak to come and to curse Israel. And in an effort to stop Balaam from cursing Israel, God gave his donkey a voice. And the donkey said, no, I'm not going to carry you to fulfill this mission because you cannot curse God's people. And if you go away and you read that story, It's quite funny, actually, because Balaam has a whole conversation with his donkey before he suddenly stops and thinks, hang on a minute, my donkey's talking to me. Balaam was unable to curse the people of Israel in the end. He was prevented from doing it by God. And so he went back to the king, King Balak, and said, I cannot bring down a curse upon these people because they're protected by God. But there's another way you might be able to get at them. And so what he suggested doing was to send women from the Moabite tribe. These women were sent in, and the men of Israel married them. They formed relationships with them. And over time, the Moabite women drew Israel away from God to worship Moab instead. And so that was Balaam's idea. Use this method to draw people away from God. Jesus also criticizes the church at Pergamum for following the teaching of the Nicolaitans. We don't know who they were. It's not made clear in Scripture who the Nicolaitans were, but we assume that because they are mentioned in conjunction with Balaam and Balak, that what they believed was something similar. It was about drawing the people of God away from worshiping him to worshiping other gods instead. And so that is why Jesus comes and he criticizes the people in the church at Pergamum and says, you're doing these things. And then Jesus goes on and he calls them to repent. The word repent appears in both of these letters, and literally repent means to turn around 180 degrees. It means if you were going this way and you repented, you would end up going that way. And so when Jesus calls them to repent, it's a recognition that the way they are going is taking them further from God, and what Jesus wants them to do is to turn around and move back toward God. So if this letter is supposed to be telling us something about Jesus, well, what does it tell us? The first thing it tells us is that he is powerful. Jesus is powerful. He's the one who wields the double-edged sword that gives him power beyond anything that we can find on earth. There is no earthly power that can go against the power of God as found in Jesus Christ. The letter also tells us that he's caring. He cares about his church because he says to them, I understand the pressure you're under. I understand where you're at. I know the context in which you are living. So he cares about them because he's bothered enough to know and understand how they are feeling at that present time. He wants his followers to be true to him. We know that because he commends them for being true to his name, but also he calls the people to turn away from worshiping other gods and to come back to the one true God. So he wants his followers to be true to him. And then there is that call. Jesus, it obviously matters to Jesus that we repent of our sin, or he would not call us to do so. And so if that's what it tells us about Jesus, he's powerful, caring, wants people to be true to him and to repent, what does it say to us? Well, I think that what Jesus is saying to us is kind of captured in the closing verses of that first letter when he says, let him who has ears hear what the Spirit says to these churches. And so the challenge of Jesus to us as we read these letters is to say, do you have ears to hear what I am saying? Are you listening for my voice, the voice of Jesus that says, turn away from worshiping the things that will do you no good and come back to worshiping the one true God through me, Jesus Christ? That's the letter to the church at Pergamum. We then have the letter to the church at Thyatira. And I was joking this morning, saying that that's one of the words that I can't actually say without seeing it written down. And if you think it's bad for me, think of our poor signer who's having to fingerspell all of these words. The church at Thyatira. What do we know about that church? Well, it was actually, of all the seven churches in the book of Revelation. It was the smallest. And it was in the smallest town. It was the church that by human standards mattered least. Fewest people in some backwater town somewhere. And yet, when we look at the size of these letters, the longest letter is to the church at Thyatira. They're the smallest, but they get the longest letter. And so that says something about how human values do not always match with God's values. Human beings would say, oh, that, leave that wee church alone. It doesn't really matter. But God says, no, you're going to get the longest of the seven letters. Jesus reveals himself in a particular way to this church. Firstly, he reveals himself as the Son of God. And we should take note of that because this is the only time in the whole of the book of Revelation that Jesus is identified as the Son of God. It's the only time it happens. By identifying himself in this way, what Jesus is doing is sharing something of his status. As the Son of God, he is acting as God's representative. He is the one who speaks with God's voice. He is the one who comes and is able to use the power of God to achieve God's ends. And so identifying himself as the Son of God is important. He also identifies himself as one whose eyes are like blazing fire and feet like burnished bronze, which is an incredible, if you try and picture that, take the picture of Jesus, whoever he is for you in terms of his physicality, and give him burning eyes and bronze feet, and you think, oof, that's a bizarre image. The reason that Jesus may have used this particular image to communicate to this particular church is because of the local industry in Thyatira. The local industry for Motherwell was steel. I was reading an article this week, actually, that it's been something like 20 years since Ravenscraig was closed down. But Motherwell was known for Ravenscraig steel, the best steel in the world. Thyatira was known for bronze. Bronze was the local industry. If Motherwell's known for steel, then Thyatira was known for her bronze, the best quality bronze you could get. And so when Jesus uses this imagery of blazing fires and burnished bronze, he's using images that the local people would have understood, because that's the employment they'd have had. They'd have been working the furnaces. They'd have been making the bronze for people. So it's an image that the local people would have understood, but I also think it depicts the supernatural nature of Jesus Christ. He's not just an ordinary man, but he's God in human form, and so there's something supernatural about him. Jesus commends this church for their deeds. He says that I know your deeds, your love and faith, your service and perseverance, and for doing more now than at first. And a number of these are self-explanatory. Love and faith is central to anyone who professes Jesus Christ. We're called to have faith in God. We're called to show his love. Service is about working in the community and helping other people and demonstrating God's love in a very practical way. And perseverance, well, it has similar connotations to what was said to the church at Pergamum. They have persevered even although they are under pressure to abandon their faith. And then doing more than at first, it seems as though the church was perhaps not doing as much as it should have been doing, but Jesus says, you're now doing more, and that's great. I'm proud of you for doing that. But just as with the church at Pergamum, the church at Thyatira has things wrong with it that need to be addressed. Jesus says that they tolerate the prophet, the woman Jezebel. Now, this is another symbolic link with the Old Testament. Jezebel was the wife of Ahab, who was a king. And Jezebel was responsible for drawing her husband away from worshiping God and worshiping Baal and Asherah. And so again, in this letter, what Jesus is addressing is the issue of people who are able to convince us, the people of God, to stop worshiping the one true God and to turn and start worshiping other gods instead. There's an amazing similarity between these two churches, and Jesus uses this Old Testament imagery to capture it. Once again, as with the church at Pergamum, Jesus calls them to repent. And again, it's this image that they have turned away from God, they're worshiping other gods, and Jesus says, I want you to turn round and come back to worshiping the one true God. And what he outlines in this letter is that there are consequences. There will be consequences for those who do not. The throwing beds, the great distress, and the utter slaughter, that's what Jesus describes in this letter. These things that follow are no doubt symbolic, but they are symbolic of the real and powerful action which the Lord will take as the one whose flaming eyes search minds and hearts to purge his people of this multiple sin. It's a quote from a favorite writer of mine, Tom Wright, capturing what is going on when Jesus uses that language. But it's also worth noting that Jesus doesn't say that this fate will fall upon everybody in this church. In verses 24 and 25, he says to those that have been holding on to Jesus, he says, I will not impose any other burden on you except hold on to what you have until I come. And so there's a sense that what Jesus is saying is you're already under the burden of pressure to abandon your faith. I'm not going to add to that burden. But what I am asking you to do is to hold on to what you have until I come. And what they had was faith in Jesus Christ. He's saying, hold on to that. Hold fast to it as the pressures come around you. Hold to that and know that I will come one day to help you, to restore you, and to be with you. So who is Jesus then? To this particular church, what does this tell us about who he is? Well, again, it tells us that he is powerful. The image at the beginning of this letter with burning eyes and bronzed feet paint this supernatural and powerful image of Jesus. He's not an ordinary teacher. He's not just a holy man, as some people would have us believe. He is the one in whom God dwells in full power. And so that is the power that Jesus has. He's powerful. But he's also all-knowing. He knows everything. He says he is the one who is able to search hearts and minds. That's actually quite an encouraging thing, especially when it comes to times like prayer. Because it means that we don't necessarily need to have the words to say when we pray, because Jesus can search our heart and our minds. And Jesus is able to know what burdens us. And so when we come to Jesus, we don't even need to say anything because he knows. He knows. We also know that Jesus is just. He's fair. Because what we see in this letter is Jesus saying that I will deal fairly with people according to their actions. If they repent and turn back to God, then what they will receive from me is the encouragement to hold to their faith. But if they continue to worship other gods and ignore me and abandon me, well, there are consequences. And the consequences that they suffer are fair, because it's based upon their own actions. The other thing we know about Jesus from this passage is that he is with those who need him, those who follow him. This is repeated throughout Scripture, but it's an encouragement for us here that Jesus says, I'm with you. Hold on to your faith until I come. And so where does that leave us today? In verse 28, Jesus talks about giving us the morning star. There's many things in that verse that Jesus promises, but this one particularly stood out to me because of what it brought to mind. The morning star is the one that normally will shine brightest just before the sun rises, and it's the indication that a new day is about to dawn. I don't know if you've ever seen a morning star. I haven't. Too early in the morning for me. Derek may have seen a morning star because he's up at that time, but not me. The morning star also shines brightest because it's contrasted against the darkness of the night, which is about to end. And so when Jesus talks about this image and giving it to those that follow him, what he is trying to encourage us to think about is that our faith, the way that we live as Christians, shines like the morning star against the darkness, the backdrop of this world. There are so many things that make this world a dark place, but as Christians, we are called to shine like the morning star. Our lives are to stand out against that darkness. But not only do we stand out, our lives are also supposed to be promises of the dawn that is about to break. Because part of the promise of the Christian faith, particularly found in the book of Revelation, is that one day Jesus will return and restore this world to the way that it was supposed to be. And that is the new dawn, the dawning of the day when God will set this world right. And so our lives shine, anticipating the dawn that is to come. Now that's difficult. It can be really hard to live and shine as though the dawn is about to come when you're still living in the darkness of this world. But Jesus still encourages us to do that, to shine like the morning star. And so the situation that both of these churches find themselves in is remarkably similar. They were worshiping the one true God, but some have turned away. And by turning away, what they are doing is diminishing the witness for Jesus of that particular church. They're not shining like the stars they're supposed to be. They're not standing up for the faith as they should. And so Jesus calls them to repent and to turn and to come back to the one true God. Christian witness is meant to be a sign of the dawning of the day, the new day, the day when God will restore this world, the day in which love, faith, service, and patience will have their fulfillment, in which idolatry and immorality will be seen as snares and delusions that they are, and in which the Messiah, Jesus, will establish his glorious reign over the whole world. That's what Jesus wants of us, to shine like stars. That's what matters to him. So go and shine in this world. Amen. And may God bless this message to us from Revelation. A song which encourages us to think about how our lives can be used by God in this world. Hymn number 528, "Make Me a Channel of Your Peace." It's a song which really captures the contrast between Christian living and the world in which Christians live. So let us stand and sing together. "Make Me a Channel of Your Peace." We have an opportunity now to give to God in our tithes and our offerings. So let us respond to this word as our offering is received. Let's share in a prayer together. Let us pray. God of all good things, we know that everything that is good has its source in you. Out of the blessings you bestow on us, we give back to you. We therefore dedicate this offering to you and to the work of your kingdom. May it be used wisely and diligently. Help us also, Lord, for these are not just coins hastily fished from our pockets. They are tokens of our very selves. Take and use us also, that we might build your kingdom brick by living brick. We lay before you as well, Lord God, our broken world, our dark and hurting world. We were grieved by the death of Father Jacques Hamel, who was killed while leading your people in worship. It is unthinkable that someone would enter a church and commit an act of violence. But this has been shattered, and now nowhere seems safe. We pray, Lord, for those who are grieving over this situation. Lord God, may we as brothers and sisters in Christ respond to this in a way which is in keeping with your will for our lives. Help us not to respond in kind by closing our doors and our borders, by cutting ourselves off from those who are most in need of your gospel. Help us to walk with courage and conviction, believing that we have the power of your Holy Spirit with us and within us, helping us tell others of the good news of Jesus Christ. Lord God, if any of us ever find our life on the line for you, help us to remember what Paul said. To live is for Christ, but to die is gain, because it is in death that we are brought home to you. We pray for anyone who faces dark days and times of bereavement. And we pray for those who have lost loved ones in recent days and weeks, as well as those whose loss has been for many years. Lord, we lift them before you and pray for your comfort and presence to be poured out upon all those whose hearts grieve. We pray as well for those who face dark and difficult times, those who are facing the diagnosis of illness or who have had to learn to live with a medical condition. Lord, we pray for your healing, your comfort, and your restoration. We pray as well, Lord God, for those who live in the darkness of poverty, who struggle to make ends meet. May they find, Lord God, their abundance in you. For you are the one who says, "Do not worry about what you shall eat tomorrow. Even the sparrows are provided for." So may they be provided for, Lord. And may you help us as your church to support them. In a moment of silence, Lord, we bring before you our own personal prayers for others this day. Lord God, we recognize that our words alone can do so little, but your presence can do so much. Remind us, and all who have lost your words of eternal life offered freely to us all. We pray for those for whom life has become too difficult to face, where hardships, deadlines, obligations, and debts weigh too heavily to see the road ahead. In places of despair, Lord, bring your light. Help us to know that the fullness of life you speak of is possible no matter our situations. Help us to shine like lights in the darkness. May we, Lord, be beacons of hope to our world, that they need not despair, but they can find hope in the name of Jesus. Be with us as we undertake this mission in your service, Lord, and as we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Our closing hymn today, hymn number 543, is a hymn which encourages us to see Jesus as our light and to allow his light to shine through us into our dark world. Christ be our light, shine in our hearts, shine through the darkness. Christ be our light, shine in your church gathered today. Let's stand and conclude our service by singing this hymn together. As you go from this place, may the power and presence of our eternal God enable you to live your life for him. May you shine like the morning star, that the world may know the love and forgiveness of Jesus Christ. And may the blessing of God descend upon you and be with you now and forevermore.